أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. And welcome to a very special edition of Perspective on ITV. My name is Faizel Patel, and tonight I am overwhelmed and honored to have with me in studio a very special guest all the way from Palestine, Dr. Abdullah Abdullah. Now, Dr. Abdullah is the head of the political committee in the Palestinian Legislative Council, or the PLC, and Deputy Foreign Relations Commissioner of the Fatah Movement. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, brother.
And welcome to ITV.
Thank you to you and to your viewers.
Jazakallah. Now, you are welcome to interact with me by sending me a mail on faizel@itvnetworks.tv. Alternatively, send me a tweet on @faizy143 or drop me a comment on facebook.com/faizelpatel. Now, Dr. Abdullah, briefly tell our viewers about yourself and what do you do?
I'm a Palestinian who is struggling with the rest of my people to gain freedom, dignity, and independence to our country. We've been fighting the occupiers of our land, and we're trying to protect our identity, to protect our religious sites, holy sites, especially Al-Aqsa Mosque, which is now in real danger, that every Muslim around the globe, not only Muslims, but even those who believe in peace, who believe in pluralism, who believe in the dialogue between the civilizations, who care for human rights, must stand up against any attempt to desecrate our holy sites, Muslim or Christian, in Palestine by the occupiers of our land, the Israelis.
Now, the Jewish and Palestinian people have a history of living well together before the establishment of the State of Israel on the 14th of May, 1948. Do you think this is possible today?
Absolutely, it is possible. We, within our ranks in the Palestinian national movement, we have Israelis, we have Jews, and they are 100% Jews, they are 100% Palestinians, but they fight against injustice. They fight against occupation. They fight for the protection and preservation of human rights. So as human beings, we should be against the discrimination. We should be against persecution. We should be against suppression and live as human beings as we did in the past, side by side. When the Jews were facing pogroms in Tsarist Russia, when they were facing the Holocaust in Western Europe, in Palestine, they found a refuge where they were welcomed as people who need to be free from fear. Unfortunately, the Zionist movement poisoned the minds of these people, and they pushed them to create a Jewish state, a Zionist state in the land of Palestine at the expense of the Palestinian people. This injustice have to end, but we're willing at the same time to accommodate, to accept those who occupied our land, who persecuted our people. We're willing to accept them as citizens, human beings, living in peace, as we want to live in peace as well.
Okay. Now, in a lecture at a meeting of the Ambassadors Club at the Interdisciplinary Center, or IDC, in Herzliya, held with assistance of the advocacy organization Stand With Us, you said that when you speak to an Israeli audience and ask those present if they have ever spoken with a Palestinian, very few raise their hands. Can you expound on this statement, and has the demographics changed?
There is more and more willingness within the Israeli society to talk to the Palestinians, because many Israelis believe that their safety, their security, their well-being comes only if their neighbors are in not being pressured, not being imprisoned, not being discriminated against. No doubt, the contacts are starting, but they're not widespread. The Israeli society is dominated by the settlers, by the extremists, by the fascists, who are driving Israel into an abyss that will make it isolated internationally and make it in a very difficult situation where even Israel's friends will not be able to defend its criminal acts, its policies, and its measures against the Palestinians. No, we are encouraging the Israelis to come over, to sit and think of a future that is good for them and for us, mutually good, not that's good for one party at the expense of the other. It might take some time, but these few voices who are now starting within Israel has to be encouraged, has to be supported from the outside world, especially within the Jewish communities abroad. And I tell you, there is a change. Last month, there was a convention in Washington, D.C. for the Jewish groups who are opposing the acts of AIPAC, the Israeli lobby, yes. Because these Jewish groups, which they call themselves J Street, they are now in a growing number in North America because they believe that the Israeli policies are not serving the interests of the Israelis or the Jews for that matter. And therefore, they wanted these policies changed. They supported the establishment of a Palestinian state because if the Palestinians are free from occupation, if the Palestinians have their state of their own, if the Palestinians are dignified in their own country, then they can accommodate their neighbors. Okay. They can give peace to their neighbors, okay. But not at their own expense. Okay.
Now, the situation in Gaza is very disconcerting. Hamas seems to be ignoring the official position of the Palestinian Authority and is also launching attacks against Israel. Your comments on this?
I don't think Hamas is launching attacks against Israel. Since, November of last year, when there was an eight-day attack, Hamas rushed to the help of Egypt, yes, to broker a ceasefire. And that ceasefire, Hamas committed itself not to carry out any aggressive attack against the Israelis. But we understand, of course, militarily, our people cannot compete with the Israelis. Our strength is in our unity, our strength in our determined struggling to achieve our goals, our national rights that we will never compromise. Our strength is the international legitimacy, is the international law, is the people of goodwill around the globe. South Africa is one of the examples of these countries because South Africa went into the struggle where the Palestinians are struggling from. The same values, to be dignified, free, and independent. These are the strength of the Palestinian people. Therefore, we would love to see our brothers in Hamas come to the fold within the Palestinian national movement. And because our prime goal now is not how to sport a beard, how short is our dress, what is the code of the dress of our women. Our main objective now is to rid our people of the subjugation, of the occupation of the foreign country that is Israel. Okay. And then after that, people will decide what system they wanted for themselves.
Now, the idea of a country for each nation and open borders for free passage is a great unifying factor. How would the Palestinian Authority provide the necessary guarantees of peace in exchange for land?
In fact, what is expected to offer assurances for peace is from the other party, yes, from the occupier. Yes. Despite all of this, we are ready to sit down and discuss the security needs of each party. Yes. And if we cannot ourselves, us and the Israelis, offer these guarantees for the security of each party, then let third party be invited in. We agreed as Palestinians, the Palestinian leadership agreed to have a third party looking for the security to give some guarantees to the one who doesn't feel assured of its security. But we cannot let the security in the hands of one of the parties, of course, because this will be at the expense of the other, and that is right. No peacemaking in this process.
In one of your quotes, you say, this mutilation of the West Bank is a deliberate political and strategic Israeli measure aimed at annihilating Palestinian dreams for a viable Palestinian state for 50 years to come. Based on that, is there a chance for a Palestinian state or unity?
The chance is there, but the chance is slipping out.
Yes.
If we are late in handling this question and reaching a solution as early as possible, as fast as possible, I'm afraid the chance of having two states will be too difficult, if not impossible. The reason is that Israel is trying every effort to create facts on the ground, make it impossible for the Palestinian land to compose a state that is territorially contiguous, that's viable, that is meeting the needs of our people. The Israeli settlement policies, that's one, which is implanting these settlements in the middle of the West Bank, enlarging the city of Jerusalem instead of 6 square kilometers. Now the city of Jerusalem, according to the Israeli designs, is 72 square kilometers. With all of this, this means that the Jerusalem area, the greater Jerusalem area, will separate the West Bank south of it from the north of it. And this Jerusalem becomes an isolated party, not connected with the rest of the Palestinian territory. This is a danger, real danger. Yes. This is why we're fighting for trying to reach a solution as early as possible. At the same time, we're fighting the policies of Israel in building settlements, creating walls in the middle of our land in order to preserve our right to have self-determination and to have right to statehood.
What is the state of Gaza at the moment?
Gaza is in a difficult situation. Gaza, it's a small area, 360 square kilometers. The inhabitants there, 1.7 million people. But Israel, since it left Gaza, because Israel's interest is not in Gaza. Gaza is too populous for Israel and too problematic. Therefore, they wanted to get rid of this demographic threat from Gaza. They're concentrating now on how to make difficulty life in the West Bank. But at the same time, they did not leave Gaza alone. They control Gaza from the sky, from the sea, and from the land. Gaza is under siege. We strive daily almost to make sure that medicine reaches Gaza, that gas for its electricity production reaches Gaza, that food reaches Gaza, that construction material reaches Gaza. Gaza, 1.7 million Palestinians who are part of our people, part of our dream, they need to survive.
Now, I understand that talks or negotiations with Israel must continue, but don't you think there must first be unity amongst Palestinian groups before you engage in talks with Israel?
We know that, yes, we're talking with the Israelis. We gave a time limit for these talks because we don't want to talk for forever. The Israelis are masters at prolonging, delaying any action. Just keep talking without any results. We set a time limit, which is 9 months, ends the end of April next. If we cannot reach a just fair solution to the questions that ends the Israeli occupation and allows for the establishment of the Palestinian state, then I'm afraid that negotiations will not continue forever. Now, about Palestinian unity. As you know, the body that is in charge with negotiations is the PLO. Yes. The PLO, and that's with the agreement of Hamas. Hamas agrees that the PLO is the body to negotiate with the enemy. But at the same time, we are in contact with our brothers to have them included in our ranks so our internal front is consolidated. Mm-hmm. So our voice is one.
Yes.
Our approach is one. That gives more strength to our negotiators. Okay.
Talks have been going on with Israel for the past 16 years. Are these talks actually leading somewhere, or are they just there to appease the people of Palestine?
No, these talks, usually negotiations, are not goals in themselves.
Yes.
They are the means to reach a solution. Any conflicting parties, they have to negotiate at one some point. The unfortunate thing is that the Israelis do not have the political will of making these negotiations, reaching their destiny, reaching their end goal, which is ending of the occupation and the establishment of the Palestinian state. This is why we insist, our leadership insisted, that negotiations cannot go forever, has to have a time limit, and we did that.
Now, Benjamin Netanyahu wants to engage in talks all the time, yet he continues to build illegal settlements. Your comments on this?
Yeah, Netanyahu and his government is the government of the settlers. It's a government that believes that the whole land of Palestine is theirs, God given to them as chosen people. Netanyahu and his government never believed in the right of the Palestinians to have a state of their own. This is why he maneuvers. He appears before, when he is subjected to some sort of pressure, mild pressure from the outer world, he appears to be conceding, going along with them. But in reality, there he lacks the political will of negotiating in good faith to reach a solution.
Okay.
And that's evident not only to the Palestinians, it's becoming evident even to the Americans, who are the brokers of the negotiations. Mr. Kerry, 2 weeks ago, he gave an interview to the Israeli television, and he warned the Israelis that their policies is leading Israel to isolation.
Now, if the European community had promised to respect the political sensitivities of South Africa, where it was once under apartheid, you can be sure it would be excoriated by progressives the world over. Now, why do you think the EU promising to respect the sensitivities of apartheid Israel?
The EU is a main player, although they don't want to appear as being competing with the Americans at the political scene.
Yeah.
Their political role is yet limited.
Yeah.
We are encouraging the European Union to take a more advanced, more escalated political role, at least in parallel with their economic role.
Yeah.
No doubt the European Union is supportive of the Palestinian National Authority, with infrastructure programs, with developments, with help, with even to our budget, they do contribute. We appreciate that. Now, lately, the European Union realized that it is not by words things will change.
Yeah.
They need deeds. This is why they agreed last July 30th that they published guidelines concerning the Israeli settlements. They consider these settlements are illegal.
Yes.
They are built outside Israel. Therefore, its products must be exempted from the tax-free agreement with Israel because they are not Israeli. They, more than that, that anyone, any group or institution that's working supportive of these settlements will be boycotted by the European Union.
Right.
This is a very positive step in the right direction. They will start implementing this guideline by the beginning of next year, January 1st, 2014.
Right.
And we hope that Europe will develop its position and take further action.
Action. Right. Now, if we have learned one thing from Hitler's crimes, it is that ethnic cleansing must be stopped wherever it occurs. Yet there are disturbing reports that the Israeli government proposes to relocate some 70,000 Palestinian Bedouins from their present homes to the government-approved townships. This is called the Proa Plan. and Israel Parliament approved it by a 3-vote majority in June. Your comments?
Listen, Israel, brother, is slipping into a fascist country. Yes. The legislations they present to the Knesset, to their parliament, is really fascist. One of them is concerning our brethren in the Negev, the Palestinian Bedouins in the Negev. They wanted to strip them, to deny them their right to their own land. They wanted to dislocate them, displace them. And one of the villages was destroyed and rebuilt 64 times in the Negev. Al-Araqib, 64 times. The Israelis destroy, the Palestinians rebuild. And that, this is what we call it, a challenge of wills between them and us. They wanted to abrogate our people wanted to deepen their roots in the land. And this is a continuous struggle, and at the end, we will succeed.
Okay. Now, give us a brief oversight on how the Israeli wall is dividing Palestinians.
This Israeli wall started 10 years ago. We took the case to the International Court of Justice in 2004, where it ruled that this wall is illegal because it is built in the Palestinian territory. It's not separating Israelis from Palestinians, it's separating Palestinians from Palestinians. Sometimes one family live on the side of the border of the wall, the other part of the family on the other side of the wall, and they cannot connect.
Of course. This
wall meant to usurp more land, meant to prevent the creation of a Palestinian state. This is why the International Court of Justice ruled very strongly against this wall as illegal, must be demolished.
Okay. Last two questions, Doctor. Do you think we will ever see the freedom of Palestine in the near future?
We are true believers that whenever there is a cause and there are people who follow that cause, struggle for that cause, they will succeed.
Okay. And last question, your closing remarks and a message to our viewers on the Palestinian issue?
Listen, this country of South Africa, that we are proud to tell that we joined struggle in the 70s and the 80s because we were fighting for the same values, dignity, human dignity, freedom, and independence. We are fortunate enough that South Africa reached its goal. We are very proud of the position taken by South Africa at all levels, at grassroots level, at the government level, at the parliamentary level, at the business community level, where they are trying to forge a policy that is consistent with its principles, consistent with international law, consistent with the freedom that they gained for themselves. They are supportive of our goals because our goals are just.
Dr. Abdullah, it has been an absolute honor
very much
to have you on Perspective on ITV.
Thank you.
We make dua, inshallah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala
inshallah
makes it easy for the Palestinian people, and one day they will enjoy the fruits of freedom that the country of South Africa enjoys.
Thank you very, very much, brother, to you and to all your viewers.
Jazakallah.
Thank you. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa ta'ala. The authors of Why Israel write, since its establishment in 1948, Israel has sought to portray itself as a state fighting for survival against Palestinians. Israel is actually an apartheid secular colonial state. Apartheid is a crime against humanity, and the international community is obliged to act against nations that practice apartheid. Israel is an international menace, destabilizing the entire world through its apartheid policies. Until the basic reality is changed and Zionist apartheid is dismantled, there can never, ever be peace. I leave you with the words of our dear Nelson Mandela, South Africa will never be free until Palestine is free. We've come to the end of another edition of Perspective. You are welcome to interact with me by sending me a mail on faizel@itvnetworks.tv or send me a tweet on @faizy143. Alternatively, drop me a comment on facebook.com/Faizel Patel. From myself, Faizel Patel, and Dr. Abdullah Abdullah, here at the ITV studios and the great ITV team, fi amanillah, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى أناجي الحق في ليل بهيم أصدق النجوى وأدعو الله من قلب سليم يطلب التقوى ظرف عصيب فاكشف البلوى فيا ربي أنا عبد لرد